But, you know, when it comes to things like consciousness and life, physics needs to be a little bit more modest and needs to understand what's within its domain of accountability and what isn't, what it can explain and what it can't. And that it shouldn't, that scientific inquiry doesn't need to be constrained and circumscribed by optional metaphysical premises that maybe were useful as kind of training wheels. I think of them as kind of training wheels, you know, that sort of mechanistic approach that led to Newtonian mechanics and so on. But at some point, maybe you need to like recognize what's on your bike, what's your bike that's really going to get you places, and what are training wheels that are holding you back. And I think that's where we are now with the mechanistic way of looking at things.
Do you think that we're being held back from further physical inquiry? Is that what this bicycle, the tricycle being too slow metaphor is talking about? Or is it something like spiritual advancement that is holding us back from?
Well, I mean, really in terms of physics, we're being held back, I think, from progress in solving a lot of these problems, by physicists not really wanting to consider this direct action picture, this transactional formulation, because it violates their training wheels, because it violates this kind of mechanical, forward, always forward directed space-time is the entire domain of what's physically real. Those kinds of presuppositions, it challenges those. And I think of those as the training wheels in the field of physics. And I mean, again, as our publications show, we already have presented solutions to problems that you'll see people, you know, I see papers constantly come out and say, measurement remains enigmatic in quantum theory. Nobody knows what a measurement is. And I'm like, well, I've been telling you what it is since 2012, you know, and Kramer did 1986. So this is that it's bouncing off, that the answers are there and they're bouncing off because the conventional approach is still, I want my training wheels, because the price for accepting these kinds of solutions is you got to let go of your training wheels, and you have to let go of your demand for what you call locality, your demand for determinism and mechanical explanations. And those are the training wheels. If you let go of those, you have answers to these problems. We've got the publications. We've got the answer to reconciling the quantum level with the relativistic level. It's out there. You know, and so when people say, we've still got this problem, this unsolved problem of how to reconcile quantum theory with relativity. Well, read the physics communications paper that we've put out in 2024. You know, the answer's out there. So it's a question of seeing it, you know, seeing that there's an answer, and maybe you don't want to see it because you don't want to lose your training wheels.
Do you believe that the primary reason for physicists not taking, say, the transactional formulation seriously is because of their recalcitrance or their ignorance, and that if only they would read it and not be so blinded by their preconceived notions that they would be accepting of it? Or do you see that actually there are some substantive issues or challenges that remain with it? Because even when I speak to people like Penrose or to Avshalom or almost anyone who has their own formulation of quantum mechanics, they'll say something similar. Like Penrose may say, well, we have this conception that there's computability at the forefront of the brain. If only we would get rid of that and we would understand that consciousness is what collapses or what is produced by the collapse of the wave function, then if only physicists would take that seriously, or Avshalom with, if only physicists would see that there is something actually unique about the now and it's not a block time, et cetera, et cetera. So almost each person will say, if only physicists would so-and-so remove their prejudice. And so I'm just curious what you think.
Yeah. Well, I do think that, you know, I wouldn't call it ignorance, but I mean, you know, it took the heliocentric, Copernicus's heliocentric model 200 years to be accepted. You know, we have to be patient, I think, for progress. Is it because, again, we, you know, there's a certain tradition, and traditions are valuable They provide structure. They do yield progress, but then they can become constraining. And it's a slow process for people, you know, in as a community, to start to get a little distance, from metaphysical conditions and see what they are first. What are my metaphysical assumptions that I'm bringing to this? Do I really need these? Are these things that are maybe not necessary? And to have the option of letting go of it, you first have to see that it's not necessary. So, you know, it's a gradual process. For those other, you know, obviously those are alternative approaches, but their interpretations. Penrose has a certain kind of a collapse formulation. His approach is actually empirically distinguishable from the conventional theory. So he has a different mechanism for collapse. But anyone, again, it's true that anyone who's challenging a prevailing, you know, conventional approach has to be patient, because it is a process of people deciding, people becoming, choosing to become aware of what am I bringing to this? Do I need to bring this in? Do I need this expectation to be an imposition on what the theory could be? Or maybe my expectation is optional and maybe nature has a different way of behaving. So it's a gradual process and you have to be patient.
What are the parts of TI that you're working on? Like, what are the holes that currently exist? And sure, they can be patched up, but where do you see its shortcomings?
Well, currently, I'm not finding any holes in the sense that it's failing to account for X. You know, I'm not finding holes. What remains to be done is to elaborate, you know, the consequences of the predictions of the model. And that's very much, I'm getting some help from some colleagues of mine, Andreas Schlatter, who's working on the general relativity aspects, and a new collaborator whose name I won't mention yet because he's maybe not fully working on it yet, but I've gotten some very promising communications from someone who's working on the quantum field theory end. So it's mainly elaborating the consequences. And I'm frankly not seeing any holes in the sense of it's falling short of accounting for X. And I haven't gotten any such criticisms. When I get criticisms, what I always find is that they're working with like an earlier version of the model that they haven't updated themselves, that the critics are not updated to the latest work and they haven't done their homework, so to speak. So I have not gotten any criticism from someone who's actually read the material saying, well, you can't explain X. You know, I haven't gotten anything like that.
Going back to holes, not with TI, but with physicalism, the response from someone like a Neil deGrasse Tyson to saying that, well, consciousness may be at the basis and physics doesn't explain everything. Hmm. He may say something like, okay, well, look, if we take a look at psychology, then that becomes neurology, which becomes chemistry, or biochemistry, which becomes chemistry, which becomes physics. At what point of this conversion is there a failure that you can point at? If you can find a point to which one of the layers doesn't emerge from the previous one, well, you'd win a Nobel Prize. Like, show me where the laws of physics fail. So what do you say to that?
Well, the laws of physics fail right away, again, on the hard problem, if Neil deGrasse Tyson assumes that matter is non-sentient. If you want to be what they call materialist.
Yeah, he claimed to be a materialist when
I was
speaking with
him. Right, well, he's already failed on the hard problem then.
Okay.
You know, and this, you can see that in his desire to reduce internal conscious experience to neurons. Neurons presumed to be made of dead non-sentient matter. That is an optional metaphysical choice that in his mind he sees as mandatory, and he wants to impose on everyone else and pass negative judgment on them if they don't do what he does. So much as I admire, you know, him, his accomplishments, that's a form of hubris in being reductionist in that way. And it's just kind of a casual, naive approach to these really nuanced, important, you know, subtle problems where he hasn't even figured out that he's already failed on the hard problem. So This is what you often get with physicist, materialist, physicalist kind of dabbling, if you pardon the expression, as being a little pejorative, in these issues where they don't even notice where they're contradicting themselves. And it's kind of embarrassing.
Now, if you had to give a single killer app, like a single great feature of the transactional approach that there are researchers who are watching, just so you know, there are professors of physics and computer science and mathematics and so on who watch, and then there are also young researchers who want to get into the field. They're listening and they want to know, okay, what would it be that if I was to play them this, the next 5 minutes or the next 3 minutes, what would it be? What would be the killer app that would make your approach superior to the alternatives?
Well, a killer app, you know, this again gets to the desire to have a formulation, have a new product, a new spin-off that the old paradigm did not predict. New, something new. We want something new. You know, like my nephew Drew, who does amazing, you know, virtual reality apps, and he's brilliant. No, I'm sorry, folks. All this gets you is a solution to the measurement problem. It gets you the reconciliation of quantum theory with general relativity. It gets you, you know, a quantum theory of gravity from a direction that maybe you weren't expecting and maybe you don't even want, but it's the solution to many purported problems. And so that's the killer app that it gets you, you know, that we need to remember that the conventional physics that people are working with fails to tell you why you ever got a measurement outcome. It fails to do that. And so that's what this will get you.
New update, started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.